Hello friends, hello and welcome. This is Arvind bringing you live from Charlotte, North Carolina. Friends, currently, as we all know, we are going through a crisis. And this crisis has engulfed the entire world. 200 plus countries are struggling under the COVID-19 pandemic. Economies are down, everything is shut down. Life has come to a standstill. Governments are trying their best to take care of their citizens. Now, in this time of crisis, it is very essential that, like, you know, not only the governments, but ordinary individuals and organizations should step up and then work shoulder to shoulder with the government. We all know there are so many people who actually, the social media like Twitter, Facebook, but they don't step out to help their neighbors or, like, you know, their countrymen. But there are other such individuals, other, like, you know, silent soldiers, what we call them, who are helping day and night people who don't even know them. Not just their neighbors, migrants, everyone, wherever there is help needed, these people are stepping up and then trying to lessen the burden of this crisis. As I said, a country or an organization or an individual, the true character of them will be known when they, the way they react to a crisis. Now, in this crisis, we have an organization whose hundreds and thousands of volunteers are working in the entire Indian subcontinent. This organization is Seva Bharati. They believe in the ancient saying from Bhagavad Gita, Seva Paramo Dharma, service is the highest religion. So we have with us today an individual who leads this organization in the state of Telangana. He is the secretary of Seva Bharati Telangana. He's also a vice president and head of information system for Genpact Business Tech. Please join me in welcoming Sri Prabala Ramamurthy. Welcome, sir. Welcome to this Telugu NRI radio show.
Thank you. Thank you, Arvind. Namaste, everyone. Good morning. Good afternoon. Just a quick introduction about myself. My name is Ramamurthy Prabhala. I'm based in Hyderabad. As a profession, I'm a software engineer. I lived and worked across the globe in many countries. Apart from work, I have been associated with social activities for many, many years. Currently, I serve as the General Secretary for Seva Bharati Telangana. A quick update about Seva Bharati and what we are.
Yeah, Mr. Seva Bharati. Sorry to cut you, Mr. Ramamurthy. Before we start, I think I just wanted to make an appeal to all the listeners. Listeners, today we have Secretary of Telangana Seva Bharati, Sri Ramamurthy. And in case you want to call, or in case you want to, like, you know, you have joined late, you want to ask him a question. If you're in US, please call us at 919-701-2005. If you're in India, 970-522-2005. And in UK, 115-888-2005. So with this, I would like, you know, pass it on to Sri Ramamurthy to introduce Seva Bharati to us.
Yeah, thanks once again, Arvind. So quick background about Seva Bharati. Folks, Seva Bharati has been around since the mid-80s. It's a national organization, service organization. It's got a federal structure where every state has its own registered body and its own committees to run the operations. The central body is basically called the Rashtriya Seva Bharati, which is an umbrella body for all the state bodies. They actually give the policies. And we actually have our own projects, programs, and execute it. The Telangana body was formed in the year 1988. And so it's been around for more than 30 years now. And they're into a host of activities, primarily into child welfare. That's basically girl child empowerment under the flagship called Kishori Vikas. And so basically the work Seva Bharati does in Kishori Vikas now for girls is basically in the slum areas, in the low-income areas, and the typical slums, basties of the city, right? We got about 210 to 20 centers of this kind in and around Hyderabad and the surrounding district. Very impactful program. Kishori Vikas is a very recognized program because we actually send our tutors every day to these slums to spend 3 hours with these girls, from the 6th standard to 10th standard, and to help them do their, you know, the homework. We also make them do things outside of education, right? Hands-on work with respect to science experiments through our science, mobile science lab. We take some guest lectures. We organize some events for them. So we try and get them to the mainstream of the society. We got a catchment of about 5,000 girls with us through this program. And what we do in a very unique way is we actually have run for a girl child program every year. So that's, we actually completed 5 years this year in the month of February. So the fifth time we conducted, and we raise about $200,000 every year during that day for the program, right? And we use the entire funding for the girl child and for some other programs. So Run for Girl Child is a registered run. It's it's a timed run, half marathon, 10K and 5K, and there's a family run. So that it's the, this run has actually evolved from a complete fun run to almost a professional run today. The other one we do is we actually run a program called Abhyasika for Boys. The same thing for again in the economically weaker sections and slums for the boys. We gather them every evening and we get them into the mainstream. We run about 20 orphanages across the state, right? Some of the orphanages are basically for tribal boys and girls. In the districts of Adilabad, we run the Ekalavya Ashram for tribal boys. And we run a very successful center in Hyderabad for girls. We call the Vaidehi Seva Ashram, where we actually nurture the girls. Once they join the ashram, they actually, until they finish their education and they're married, we take care, right? So that's the kind of commitment, we give them. The other thing we do is we run health centers. We have a mobile, we've got two mobile health centers, which go around the areas around Rangareddy district, Hyderabad, other parts of the state, and along with medicines and a physician, and they do medical service, right, at fixed points every day. Beyond this, we also have started moving to skill development. We got a very modern skill development center that's coming up in Kukatpally, Hyderabad for women. And we're getting only women-focused medical skill development center in Bhuvanpally. So we built, there was a lady who gave us her own house, and we actually built up that house into a four-storied now, and we're going to do a central government-sponsored nursing assistant skill development program starting next month, right?
Okay.
Every batch will be having about 50 girls. The qualification is +2, and we train them up, and then there's a lot of demand for nursing assistants in the country today. And we expect 100% employment with this skill. So gradually we're moving from service into the next phase of evolution into skill development. We already have a skill development center in Warangal, where we partnered with Godrej, and we trained boys in the areas of electricity, electrical vocational courses, refrigeration repair, air condition repair, and we got one more in Mahbub Nagar. So this is the expanse of work, and completely run by volunteers, though we have some full-timers whom we pay a salary, but the executive committee is completely professional and run by people like us.
So that is very good to know, Mr. Ramamurthy, that you're not just leaving them stranded, like, you know, take care of them, like, you know, at a young age and then leave them stranded. You are, like, taking them all the way so that they become self-reliant, both boys and girls. That's what I see from, like, you know, the skill development and all that. So they can earn their own livelihood. So that seems to be, like, you know, the ultimate goal. But before we dig in deeper on this, I would like to, like, you know, ask few questions. We'll go there, like, you know, onto what exactly you do. We'll do a deep dive. But my first question would be, like, you know, what made you choose Seva Bharati? There are so many organizations scattered around, like, you know, across the country. Why Seva Bharati?
I think I used to lead the CSR arm of Infosys when I was with Infosys, called Mamata. And I also used to lead the CSR arm of Capgemini called VK when I was at Capgemini. So I have experience in running service organizations. And I came across Seva Bharati about 8 years back. And what I noticed in Seva Bharati was it's a completely voluntary-driven program. Organization, and the response for service was very spontaneous and immediate and most selfless. And so I thought, and also the management cost of running Seva Bharati is nothing because it's complete voluntary, right? So I thought it's very transparent, agile and grounded organization rather than publicity seeking. So I thought that suits me.
Okay, that's good to know. Yeah, transparency is very important when it comes to charitable, voluntary, like, you know, service-based organizations. Okay, I would like to, like, know more, little more about the structure of Seva Bharati in Telangana. You are the secretary of Seva Bharati. Like, how many districts do you have presence? How many volunteers approximately are, like, you know, managing? I think before I ask you that question, I think before you answer that question, I think we may have a caller. Let's take a call. Namaste, who's this? I think maybe we got disconnected. Hello?
Yeah, I'm there. From a structure...
No, one second, Mr. Ramamurthy. Hello, who's this? Can you introduce yourself? I think we may have some technical connection issue here. Is the caller there? Welcome to Telugu NRI Radio. I think we got disconnected. Sorry. So please go ahead.
Yeah, you can stop me whenever there's a call. That's okay.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so it's a registered body, registered with Government of India, Register of Societies. And so we have the structure as advised by the government. So we have a president, Mr. Durga Reddy, and I'm the secretary, and we got two joint secretaries. One Ms. Jayaprada and one Ms. Subramaniam. And then we got a treasurer. That's the executive committee. And then we got a list of about, you know, 6-7 members who are part of the organizing committee in the state. So we meet every month, review projects, review any urgent needs, review any budgetary demands, review the spend, review the requirements of funds for new projects, you know, stuff like that. So we have a proper engine working to run the organization.
Okay, and how many volunteers approximately do we have on the ground?
So I'll just split it. Basically, we've got about 25-30 full-time employees, and the voluntary base will be about 3,000 plus across the state, and we are present across the 30 districts of Telangana.
That is very good. Okay, now you have mentioned about, like, you know, running hostels and skill development. So approximately how many, in total, people you have helped? Any idea, any rough estimate?
Typically, the hostels, the 25 hostels we have, at any point of time, we'll be having about 25 to 30 residents each of them, right?
Okay.
So that's about 700, is the capacity. And typically, once someone who joins will stay with us for at least a couple of years till he completes his 12th. Some of them go up to graduation, but most of them leave by 12th. In terms of the people who have benefited, if you take the skill center in Warangal, Madikonda, we have a record of at least 100 plus who actually got trained and are now doing something on their own or working with a center of a Godrej or Samsung or whatever.
Oh, that is very good to know.
Yeah.
I have to just interrupt you. I think we have a caller. Hello. Welcome to Telugu NRA Radio. Who's this? Yeah, please continue, Mr.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So the Vairehi Sevashram, we completed about 40 plus marriages of girls who actually came and stayed with us and whom we took care all the years, right? That's something we do. And broadly, in terms of the orphanages, a lot of kids from underprivileged sections, single parents, no parents, they stay in our orphanages and then they move out and they become. Recently, one person from the Mehbub Nagar district is selected in the Indian Army and is posted in Kashmir. So he came back and met us after his posting is over. So a lot of such cases of success stories, people who are with us and who moved on to doing something on their own, getting employed with the government or private sector. So it's pretty.
Okay. Very good to know, actually. I want to actually just foray into this COVID-19. I mean, you already have a presence, in doing service to the society. So how did COVID-19 change? I see, on social media that Seva Bharati is doing a lot during this COVID-19 pandemic lockdown. So how did you get into this, doing charity in this area?
So I think COVID was a very unique situation for service organizations. Unlike other calamities, where the service organizations were invited to take part in the support programs by the government, in the case of COVID, there's a problem because of the nature of the virus, right? The government was unwilling to initially, collaborate with the NGOs because of the fear that the NGOs themselves, the folks on the ground, may actually carry the virus and then spread, correct? And so the initial couple of days, they were not willing, actually for a week or so. But so once we had, I think May 21, we had a nationwide curfew called Janta Curfew in India, May 21, I think. And May 23rd onwards, we had the lockdown.
Mm-hmm.
So on May 23rd, we had a meeting at Seva Bharati and we said, so guys, I think there is something we need to do. We need to give a response to the situation. We didn't have any government approvals to get onto the streets. But we were aware that once it's locked down, there'll be problems on the ground because look at Indian economy and people making a living, it's a lot of people in the unorganized sector, right? From look at your maids, your drivers, your, you know, your cab drivers, your auto drivers, you know, your chaiwala. So 90% of the country is on its own, right, in terms of employment. And so we definitely thought there's a need for us to jump in and do whatever we can. So I think within a day or two, we started raising funds, by the way, and we reached out to our corporate people, all the corporate contacts. We made a proposal, proposals. We reached out to social media and started collecting funds. So fundraising was not a problem because people knew the gravity of the situation, and they were, they're giving the 500 rupees, 1,000 rupees, you know. So there was a constant flow of funds. Response of the people was very, very good. We needed to craft a program. So what should we do? Because one, there's a scare that the virus is was strong and it's impacting people's ability to move freely. And we didn't have gloves, masks, sanitizers, all this stuff yet. But, you know, we pulled people around we started first distributing the food kits, right? We called the family kit. So the family kit had groceries enough for a family of four for a month, correct? We activated all the main regions of the city and the state, and asking people for data. We got a, let's say, 100 hardmans who are basically stone cutters, right? There's no stone cutting happening. So do they need help? So we send a person there, you know, take the names, gather data. So what exactly they need? So they need food. So we actually pack up this 100 bags, deliver it to them, correct, for a month. It was a very specific and pointed effort. It was not like generally giving away stuff. We did not do that. We activated all the volunteers. We reached out on the social media, and we put a number, a cell phone number where people can call and tell us we need support. So whoever called us, we actually sent a representative to check, right, if there's a real need or not. Because government was also giving the food, and we didn't want to waste our resources giving to the same person twice, correct? So in case people did not have an identity card, they would not get from the government. So those are the people we actually wanted to support, or people who came from other states who don't have a local identity. Probably they can't go to the public distribution shop, or the government refuses. So those kind of people we identified and ensured the last mile delivery is done efficiently. So I think we reached out to a large section of people in this way. And not all went through the Seva Bharati funding also. The volunteer base themselves, they formed teams in the local areas and sought fundraising from the local apartment complex, local communities. And over time, they started distributing stuff themselves. So we started the program, and the chain actually went to the last mile. So the funding also started being taken care of by the locals itself, right? So that's the kind of system that got built over the last 2 months.
That is actually very good to know that it actually inspired people at the local level. But before we move forward, I just wanted to make an appeal. Listeners who have joined a bit late, today we are talking about Seva Bharati, the service it is doing during COVID-19. We have with us the Secretary of Seva Bharati Telangana, Sri Ramurthy Prabala. If you have any questions, please do call us, to ask a question, or you can appreciate the work they are doing. If you are in US, 919-701-2005. In India, 970-522-2005. And if you are in UK, 115-888-2005. And if for any reason your calls are not going through, we would request you to call us on Skype at Telugu NRI Radio. I think Skype calls would be easy to manage. So do call us once again. Our Skype ID is Telugu NRI Radio. So let's continue the discussion. So can you outline, Sri Ramamurthy Garu, like, you know, what are the broad range of things that you are actually doing? Like, you know, one is the grocery kits that you have distributed. Apart from this, are there any other activities, like, you know, just a bigger picture that Seva Bharati is doing?
Yeah. So one is the family kit. The other is the sanitary kits, right? That includes soaps, hand sanitizers, and masks, right? For families. That's the and then we distributed the masks separately. Mask was a different program where we went into the market yards and started distributing the masks to the vegetable vendors, right? We also did a lot of work for the government hospital, especially the Gandhi Hospital, which is the main backbone in Hyderabad for the COVID-19. Gandhi Hospital, we are recognized as the number one NGO. We actually reached out to them and giving them the doctors, the personal protection equipment, PPE, they call it. We were the first one to give them a lot of PPEs. I think we get about 2,000 PPEs to Gandhi Hospital, and they're very expensive. We also delivered multiple boxes of sanitizers across the hospital. And we also installed a disinfecting tunnel at the Gandhi, two of them actually. So okay. People who go in actually get disinfected. So that's expensive equipment, but we installed that, two of them in Gandhi. And the same thing we did for Nizamabad Government Hospital. We got a request from them that they're looking for support for the PPEs, masks, sanitizers, and the tunnel. So we just went ahead and installed the same thing in Nizamabad. So in the health sector, I think we good portion of the money we raised as funds went into health, basically the sanitizing part of it, right? So that's something we did. And also we did, what we did was we did a lot of programs on the social media with doctors. So we actually organized a team of doctors with a helpline number. And anyone who's got a question, who needed counseling on COVID, so they can actually call that that number, and one of the doctors who is free will pick up and talk to you. That is still going on. So that's a free counseling from doctors. That's something we did. The other thing we did was we organized ourselves into a core team and a ground level team. And the core team we used to meet twice a week, every other day. Mm-hmm. And we used to talk about where is urgent need in the society right now. Do we have the problem of the migrants? So we know there's a problem of migrants. So we actually reach out to the police. Guys, where do you need help? So we actually provide some 18 to 20 buses for migrants to redraw from Hyderabad to UP, Chhattisgarh, Bihar, you know, Srikakulam, Bhuvaneshwar, you know, you name it. So that's a very, very significant service. In fact, one of the police guys told us, if at all some help is needed in this COVID, you know, sending migrants to their homes is a great service, and I think you guys have done a great job. So that's something we did. Yeah,
that is indeed, like, you know, a big big one. Like, you know, as we can see, I think this whole COVID-19, I think this migrant thing has been a big challenge for the government. And then you said you are operating 20 buses. That's a big number. But do you just, like, you know, I just have a question related to that migrant, the transportation. Do you just put them on the bus and then, like, you know, drive them, or do you even provide them something, like, you know, for the journey, like, you know, some food or anything until they reach the destination?
So all the buses, before they leave, we give enough food, including the driver, right? Okay. Everyone is given food before they leave and for the night, or for the day if they start in the night. So food is, of course, most important. That includes includes rice, chapati, and then bananas and stuff like that. So that's a given. And I think for the railway station, we actually provided one day when the government opened up migrant labor. So we worked with the government of Telangana and the police department, and they asked us to provide food for all the migrants going from the Lingampally, Sikinderabad, Nampally, and Kachigoda stations. So we are talking about that day, at least about 25,000 migrants, right? And so that I was handling one of the stations in Lingampally. 6,000, at least 5 to 6,000 people we provided food. So we collaborated with Akshay Patra because they produce mechanized food, right? Mm-hmm. So we ordered food from Akshay Patra and then hot meals, absolute hot sambar rice, packed and delivered to them when they're actually getting into the station, right? It's very well organized with the government this time. No chaos, you'll be surprised. No chaos, people coming one by one, social distance, and then our volunteers, everybody volunteers giving enough food, including government also gave some food. So it's a lot of food given to the labor that day. Yeah.
Okay, so 25,000 meals or like, you know, packets definitely is a very big number. And I'm indeed, like, you know, very surprised that so much has been done, and then it is very, like, you know, the volunteers have really stepped up. I can see that based on the sheer volume of the seva that is happening. My next question is, like, you know, you have mentioned about, like, you know, raising funds and all, like, you know, are you getting any assistance from the Telangana state government or, like, you know, any other funds from any government agencies?
I think we don't get any funds from the government directly, but they seek our help. So they formed a WhatsApp group called Migrant Labor Transport, right? Mm-hmm. And we are an official partner, we added to that. And so they direct all the requests to us, correct? But the help we got from the government is, you know, a free pass for any Seva Bharati vehicle or personal moving around the state in the last 2 months. That's a big help. So we could move people or material and our personnel to various locations to distribute food, material, you know, do whatever. So we had a free pass. That's the help we got from the government.
Okay, so everything you have done is on your own. Like, you know, you raised the funds for it, and then all the government was doing was facilitate.
It's all, government is facilitating, obviously, and we just, you know, take the approvals and do a lot of stuff.
Okay. Now, you have mentioned about these sanitizing tunnels and then, like, you know, giving masks to the doctors and hospitals and, like, you know, market yards and all. Have you trained your volunteers to do these things? Because, see, so many cases, like, you know, propping up across India, and then people are scared to even go out. So how are your volunteers able to work in these serious situations?
So the volunteers have been trained on call, strict social distance, wearing a mask, wearing gloves, carrying a hand sanitizer in their pocket.
Correct. Okay. Mr. Ramurthy, I think we have a caller. Hello. Welcome to Telugu NRA Radio. Who's this?
Namaste, Andy. My name is Nirmala. I just have one question about... So about the Gurukulams, is there any Gurukulams in Telangana?
Okay. So
what do you mean by the question?
So I heard, like, a lot of Seva Bharati is running some Gurukulas recently in some places. So I'm just trying to find out if there are any in
Okay.
The ancient times we had Gurukulams, they're teaching everything, our culture and also the education along with that.
Okay, so I got the question. I got the question. So, ma'am, so we don't, Seva Bharati does not run any Gurukula, okay? But you're talking about Swaminarayan Gurukul. There are Gurukuls run by other institutions, typically the MUTs, which provide such kind of education. One of the famous ones in Hyderabad is Swaminarayan Gurukul. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for calling Telugu NRA Radio, Ms. Nirmala. So, listeners, again, who have joined late, today we have Secretary of Seva Bharati Telangana, Sri Ramamurthy Prabhala, and we are going over the service, awesome service that is being done by the organization. I think we have another caller. Hello, welcome to Telugu NRA Radio. Who's this? Can you introduce yourself? Are you able to hear me? Can you introduce yourself, please? Hello, sir. Can you hear me? Okay, I think we may have some difficulty there. So let's continue with our discussion. So your volunteers are being trained to be, like, you know, to take all the precautions. That's what, like, I think was our the last thing we were discussing. There's one more question, like, you know, that I have related to this. We have seen across India there were some challenges, like, you know, for the frontliners. A certain section of the community, like, you know, they were misled, they were attacking them, and then, like, you know, a lot of aggravation was happening on that end. Did Seva Bharati volunteers face any such situation where they were, like, you know, not treated or not welcomed for their service? I think before you answer that, Mr. Ramamurthy, I think we have a caller. Hello, sir. Welcome to Telugu NRA Radio. Can you speak up, please? Hello? Can you introduce yourself, please? I think if you have a challenge connecting with the phone, you can please reach us on Skype, Telugu NRI Radio, and then ask your question or appreciate the work done by Seva Bharati. So kindly call us on Skype ID, Telugu NRI Radio. So continuing that, I want to repeat the question, Mr. Ramamurthy. That is, did you or your volunteers face any kind of challenges, like, you know, the way some of the frontliners were attacked across India, many places? Did those things happen with your volunteers in Telangana?
So, Telangana, we actually reached out to all sections of the society, and we were warmly received by everyone. So we didn't face any problem here. But to your question, there are definitely instances in other states where the Seva Bharati volunteers had to face problems, but not in Telangana.
Okay, so Telangana was okay. That is good to know. See, continuing this service, it's been going on for, like, you know, like more than 2 months now. Could you give us, like, you know, some statistics on how much food did you distribute, or how many sanitary kits, like, did you did Seva Bharati supply? Like, you know, do you have any stats, like, you know, maybe for the overall state or for Hyderabad, or, like, you know, something you can share so that we can understand the magnitude of service that Seva Bharati is doing?
Oh, I'll bring that up. Why don't you ask the next question while I just, you know, bring the data up? I got the
statistics. Okay. My next question would be, like, you know, this is not only, like, you know, a lot of COVID-19 has brought us, like, you know, new challenges. Lockdown for close to 2 months. I think we have never seen that, actually. So there are, like, a lot of stress, mental challenges, like, you know, physical challenges. Like, you know, are your volunteers, like, you know, trying to help overcome that, because people are not able to exercise, not able to go out constantly, like tied down among like in the four walls. Anything your volunteers or your organization is doing to help people in that area?
Yeah, so I told you we set up a 24/7 medical call center, and okay. There are a group of doctors who volunteered, about 20 of them, that they will, you know, work with Seva Bharati, and that's published on a website. So people who want medical help, they can just call us, any related with psychological. So we actually organized two events with a counselor online, and a lot of people joined to, you know, have the questions answered. But from a medical perspective, we have a strong team that is helping people. So Arvind, I got data with me.
Please go ahead.
I'll just read out the data. So the beneficiaries is basically got about 10 lakh beneficiaries approximately in the last 2 months. And food kits is about 2 lakh food kits. Highway kitchens, about 65,500. Meals served is about 3.5 lakhs. Doctors online for counseling, it's 256. Vegetable kits distributed is about 60,000. Ayurvedic immunity, immunity medicine served is about 1.25 lakhs. Blood units donated is about 1250. Hospital cleaning instances is 544. Migrant labor kits is about 28,000. Refreshment centers, 284. Kits for nomadic population, that is about 12,900. I think I talked about the food kits, about 2 lakhs. For migrant workers, we established 36 food distribution centers. Beneficiaries, about 2 lakhs. Medical aid centers for migrant workers, 385 beneficiaries. Vehicles arranged for migrants, 161, about 8,000 beneficiaries. Medical aid, gloves, PPEs, masks, sanitizers, medicines, and disinfection tunnels. So total districts in Telangana, 33. Volunteers is 23,078. And centers we have is 2,932. So broadly, that's the data.
Wow. I can, like, you know, I'm really, really amazed, Mr. Ramamurthy. I think this kind of service, you have touched like a million population, and then, like, you know, so many lakhs of kits. And you had mentioned that each kit is for 1 month, right? That is really, really awesome. And I think on behalf of Telugu NRI Radio and its listeners, I just want to once again extend my, like, you know, congratulations. And then, like, you know, I salute your volunteers for this amazing work. And the sheer magnitude of work is really praiseworthy. Friends, it's really great indeed that, like, you know, an organization has done so much of Seva. So if you are listening to this program, kindly reach us at Skype ID Telugu NRI Radio. You can ask a question or appreciate the great work done by them. It is
Thank
very
you.
Amazing, Mr. Ramamurthy.
Hello.
Yeah, hi. Who's this?
Yeah, namaste, Arvind Garu. My name is Vilas Jambula. I'm calling from New Jersey. Can I talk to Ramamurthy Garu?
Yeah, please. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Ramamurthy Garu, namaste. I'm calling from New Jersey, USA. Sir, Seva Bharati is doing wonderful job. Congratulations to you, behalf of Telugu NRI Radio. And I want to know one thing, sir. All RSS volunteers and whatever Seva Bharati is doing, these programs are not coming in media, electronic media or print media, nowhere. We got only somewhere in the some place like Facebook or some of the groups or something. So why this is happening? It is happening from long time. So why is not coming in the media especially? Why not start some newspaper or something what volunteers are doing articles? So
yeah, indeed, very good question, Mr. Vilas. I think I had my next question, like, you know, on the same lines. So this is the magnitude of work done, and then I did not see much about it, like, you know, on the media, to the magnitude that it is, it should be reported. So as Mr. Vilas has asked, like, you know, how is the media supporting you? Is it, I mean, supporting you? Or if it is not, what is your plan so that, like, you know, this awesome work can be taken into the public so that we can inspire many more people?
Yeah. So I think one is, I think by nature, the organization is conservative with respect to media and publicity, point one. However, I would hasten to add, in this case, for the COVID effort, we have been covered very well by the local media, point one.
Okay.
And in fact, I think for the first time, Seva Bharati has become very very noted NGO in the state. I can, because the DGP of Telangana, the chief secretary, and all of them actually have tweeted about the work we are doing, correct? And so it's pretty, it's big. So I think it's got enough recognition in the media. But if you took it, if you look at, because Vilas talked about Sangha and its service activities, if you look at the national coverage, TV channels like CNN, IBN, and which are considered to be antagonist to RSS, they also covered the work being done by RSS activists across the country in COVID. So, for example, they covered the activity of the COVID testing being done by Swayamsevaks in Pune and Bombay, correct? That's only, okay. There's the first non-governmental organization doing tests for COVID patients in the country, right? They got the approval, they bought the kits, and they're doing testing. That's a huge coverage. But if you guys are on Twitter and social media, Facebook especially, I think the coverage is pretty good, not bad. Because for the effort we actually put in to publicize our work, we got a significant coverage this time. It's not that bad.
Okay. So good to know that, like, you know, this time media definitely is not ignoring. And I think because the service speaks volumes, like, you know, the like, you know, about the great work your volunteers are doing, and there is no option for them now because nobody else, like, you know, is out there except, like, you know, volunteers related to, yeah, like, you know, these right-wing organizations. This is indeed a nice change that we can see, and hopefully this continues even after the lockdown. So moving on to the next question, like, you know, how would, like, you know, one connect with Seva Bharati? Like, you know, do you, like, yeah, how do you enlist, like, support or enlist volunteers? Like, you know, how does you increase, how do you increase your strength?
Yeah. We have got corporate volunteers. So we reach out to all corporates, and we include their employees in our program. So we call it the corporate volunteer program. We also have the individual volunteers on our website. They can register on www.sevabharati.org, where you can register. We have a phone number where people can call, and then, you know, we connect with them back. We also provide today internships. So we got people studying in the US and other countries who are coming back home for the summer. And we've got a couple of them actually doing internship with us now. 3 months, 3 months internship, 2 months internship. They spread the word for us. And so I think these are the couple of channels. One is the individual volunteers who can register on the website. A lot of it is word of mouth. Corporate volunteers, because we go to corporates, talk about our work. We ask them to visit some of the centers where we do our work, and some of them get inspired and start working with us. And then we have internships and things like that, which actually improves our base.
Okay. So I just wanted to, like, you know, clarify something. So you are saying that NRIs can also be part of your service programs in summer when they visit India and then try to learn. Yes. So is that what you have mentioned?
Yes, it is. Yes.
Okay. Is there a way NRIs can also donate to Seva Bharati? Is that allowed? And if so, how can they do that?
Yeah. So we have an FCRA. So we can donate directly to Seva Bharati. We can share the details. And we also work with a partner NGO in the US, Seva International. And people who wish to donate for a cause in India can donate to Seva International and let us know. And then we work with Seva International to ensure the transaction is completed.
Okay. So NRIs who are listening to this show, you can actually connect with Seva Bharati, and then, like, you know, you can be part of their, like, you know, volunteer program when you visit India. And if you have any questions related to this, you can please call us. And then callers, when you are calling, please speak up. I think we have a caller. Hello, who's this?
Namaste, Andy. I'm Venkat Nukula, community leader in Australia.
Yeah, namaste, Venkat Garu. How are you? Welcome to Telugu Nara Radio. You have a question?
Yeah, Garu. Arete Seva Bharati nunchi mitrulu. ఈ రోజు మన కార్యక్రమానికి ఎన్ఆర్ఐ తెలుగు రేడియోకి వచ్చారు వారికి అండ్ ఎన్ఆర్ఐ తెలుగు రేడియోకు కృతజ్ఞతలు తెలియజేస్తున్నా అండ్ కంగ్రాచులేషన్స్. అండ్ క్వశ్చన్ వైజ్ గా సేవాభారతి కార్యక్రమాలు కేవలం ఇండియాలోనే కాకుండా ప్రపంచవ్యాప్తంగా కార్యక్రమాలు జరుగుతున్నాయి ఆ విషయం నాకు పూర్తి అవగాహన ఉంది. కానీ అనుకున్న విధంగా ఈ సౌత్ ఈస్ట్ ఏషియాలో ఎక్కువ కార్యక్రమాలు తక్కువ ఉన్నాయి. ఎందుకంటే నేను ఆస్ట్రేలియా న్యూజిలాండ్ లో దాదాపు 27-28 సంవత్సరాలు అయింది. అయితే వారికి ఈ పెసిఫిక్ ఏషియా పెసిఫిక్ లో కార్యక్రమాలు ఎలా ఉన్నాయో, వారు దానికి ఏ విధంగా స్పందిస్తారో వారి అభిప్రాయం తెలియజేస్తున్నామని ఈ ఫోన్ కార్యక్రమంలో పాల్గొనడం జరిగిందండి.
ఓకే, ఐ థింక్ టు ద లిసనర్స్, ఐ థింక్ ద కాలర్ ఫ్రమ్ ఆస్ట్రేలియా మిస్టర్ వెంకట్ వాంట్స్ టు నో if at all there are any like seva activities done by any affiliates like, you know, in the Pacific region. So Shri Ramurthy ji, like, you know, you have any
So I think Venkat, namaste andi. So basically namaste, in the Southeast Asia lo we have presence in you know, we do some activity in Singapore and Malaysia, but Australia and New Zealand we don't have presence, okay, and even in Japan, but our affiliate organizations, we call it the international arm of RSS, they do work in that region. So I can give the specific contacts if you want. Yeah, but there's work happening, but not in an organized way, like under a banner. But definitely work is happening. People meet, they talk about service, they reach out to communities there, they help, and that work is happening. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much for asking that question. Thank you for your call. I think we are almost, like, you know, coming to the end of our discussion here, but, like, you know, I have like a couple of more questions. Among the so many seva activities that are going on during this COVID-19 crisis, Mr. Ramurthy, what is the one activity you feel had made a very big impact? The one that maybe, like, you know, you like it the most, or you think has made a big impact on the society?
I think definitely helping the migrant laborers reach their destinations, right? Helping them get onto the bus or helping them get onto a train, I think that's been the most satisfying.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is there
because
any...
That's where the government also struggled, and that's where people like us pitched in and alleviated the problems of the migrants. Yeah.
Okay, so this migrant crisis is a new challenge that everybody has actually come across right now. Before this, nobody even bothered, like, you know, things were happening
the way they were. Because the migrant, no one envisaged the numbers. No one has the data, the exact migrants in each metro of the country, right? So fundamentally, the migrants are, you know, 80% of the metros, right? And there's no data with any state government or the central government. And so they kept on underestimating the numbers. And so even as of yesterday night, we the two trains, we actually served 500 meals yesterday itself in one of the stations nearby. People were going to Orissa, right? So I think it's a lack of data. And I think the government did not have the problem of trains. I know they were saying that they can run as many trains, but there was no data precision to determine how many numbers of trains and what frequency, which state they need most. Is it to UP, Bihar, or Orissa, or whatever, right? So so I think that was the problem.
So now that we know there is a, this is like, you know, an area of concern, like, you know, even after lockdown, right, the migrants are going to come back. Is like Seva Bharati thinking something like, you know, to do some work in that area, help the government or work with the government to do something positive for them?
We are actually shifting gears now. So now the providing the succor is complete, right? I mean, that activity is over now. So what we're planning now is to, one, work with the government and ourselves on what kind of skills are required post-COVID, correct? For these people who are coming back. So we're actually working on a war footing. So we're setting up a center for employment with a full-timer who is going to map the requirements of the industries with the type of people who we have available with us. So a lot of the migrant labor who actually are going back will have to come back probably in a month or two, right? Maybe they'll be staying back for the harvest. I mean, so the crop season will start because the monsoon is coming to India now, right? So in 2 months, they should be free. They will come back. And once they come back, we need to map their skill and then direct them to the, you know, where the job is. So we started that activity now. So we'll create a platform for that. And we're trying to go social on that. That's the next activity.
So you're using technology to map skill with the work and then, like, you know, trying to, like, you know, have a hold on the migrant population and help the government. Yeah, that indeed is, like, you know, a very good initiative. Keep us posted when it is ready so that, like, you know, we also can share that. I think we have discussed a lot of stuff and then we have known a lot of things about Seva Bharati, and then clearly the sheer magnitude of Seva the organization has done with the help of its volunteers is, like, you know, is absolutely praiseworthy. My question to you is, like, you know, you have, like, you know, a full-time job and not a small one, like, you know, you manage big teams, like, you know, for a big company, and you also manage this awesome Seva also. And I think before I continue or complete my question, I think we have a caller. Hello, who's this?
Hi,
welcome to Telugu Nara Radio.
Hi, this is Kapil from Hyderabad.
Yeah, hi, Kapil. Thanks for calling.
I just want to ask a simple question. Like, you know, I've seen, like, a lot of people who are trying to, you know, do a lot of contribution and doing volunteers. You know, there was a small problem. You know, a few people wanted to join, but they have a scariness that even they might get affected, you know, to COVID. So I just wanted to know, you know, just to inform other people that, you know, the Seva Bharati is taking a lot of precautions in terms of making sure no volunteer is being affected with COVID. So can I know that, is there any anyone get affected with COVID or something like that? Any volunteer I need to say?
No. Yeah, Kapil, thanks for the question. Yeah, no one. Thank God this. Okay. No one actually got infected. Yeah. So, yeah.
Yeah, the reason I ask, because, you know, a lot of people want to come forward and do a lot of contribution, but they have some kind of a scariness in their heart that maybe, you know, I might get affected with this, so it's better I just, you know, stay back home rather than, you know, going out and do some kind of a contribution. So I wanted to just know this so that I can tell people, I know, yes, there is, you know, Seva Bharati is taking a lot of precautions, so volunteers can really come forward and, you know, do the contribution. in terms of physically, you know, physical contribution, I mean to say. Distribution of, you know, maybe masks or distribution of, you know, kits or any kind of, you know, physical help which they want to do.
Okay. Thanks, Kapil. Actually, that's indeed a great question. Because whoever wants to volunteer, they definitely should be, like, you know, made comfortable that there is no issue or none of their volunteers were infected with COVID. I think before we go to the question, Mr. Ramamurthy, I wanted to ask you, like, you know, I think we discussed a lot about COVID-19 stuff. I just wanted you to, like, you know, go over, like, you know, some of the your mainstream work that you had mentioned at the beginning. Like, you know, can people or, like, you know, NRIs from here, can they contribute to any of such causes? Like, you know, you had mentioned about the girl child, like, you know, training, like, you know, in some skills, like, you know, can you, like, you know, elaborate a little bit more and then, like, you know, enlighten the NRIs?
Yeah, most welcome. We need all support required because we're coming up with, as I told, you know, specifically the women skill development center in Bhuvanpally, Hyderabad, for the nursing assistant programs. It will be a government sponsored or rather government approved program, and 100% employment guaranteed in private sector hospitals for these girls, and most of them will be coming from rural areas. We're setting up a center. It's in a with a lot of cost. They need help there. And the other center we're setting up, again for women this time, it's in Kukatpally. The building is ready. We're just trying to set up some equipment. This will be most related to things like, you know, tailoring and modern stuff there. And a fabric-related work stuff. So that's in Kukatpally. So these two centers, we invested heavily. We're also setting up a center for, skill development center for nomadic tribes in Neredmet. And the building is ready. We're trying to get, again, computer center there. So one in Mehubnagar, Skill Development Center, and one in Warangal. So a lot of activities. People interested in girl child empowerment, please get in touch with us. We'll involve you in some activity. You can help us with right from research, documentation, data analysis, digital marketing, you know, writing communication to government on behalf of us. So a huge set of activities. You all are welcome to participate.
Okay. Thank you for the information. And then is there any other, like, you know, activity you had mentioned about orphanages? Like, you know, is there any scope for people to?
Yeah, orphanages, we have the young boys and girls. You know, definitely you can take under your coverage, you know, a couple of boys and girls in each orphanage, sponsor them for a year, for a couple of months, or whatever you want to do. That's a very, very popular way. People contribute for one girl, one boy, or a couple of boys. You know, that's because a lot of the orphanages are in towns, tier 2 towns, tier 3 towns, and fundraising is very difficult. And most of the times, we have to, from the central office, send money for the monthly purchases. And, you know, if you guys come forward and, you know, support, it'd be great help for us, definitely.
Okay. Is there a way, like, you know, any of us who visit, like, you know, from abroad, like, you know, spend some time there? Because giving, like, you know, some fund definitely is, like, you know, helpful. But again, actually coming there and seeing how things go motivates, like, you know, not only the adults but also the kids. They understand, like, you know, how fortunate they are compared to others, and then, like, you know, might motivate them to join this service. Is that possible, Mr. Ramamurthy?
Yes. In fact, you can go and stay there for a night. Most of the orphanages are very well maintained. Anyone interested to visit any of our centers or orphanages or the work, you know, Arvindji asked them to get in touch with me. There's a sevabharti.org. We got a number. They can call it. Call that number and then we'll help you, you know, take you there, whatever. We'll arrange stuff.
Okay, that is good to know. So NRIs, if you are ever like, you know, visiting India and Telangana, so do plan to visit one of the Seva Bharati service center or their orphanage or their skill development center, indeed to understand like, you know, what great work they are doing to help the society. And all this is done by their volunteers who are not paid. It's just the motivation to serve the country. That's what more, like, you know, brings them to work with Seva Bharati. So indeed, you can join them or you can, like, you know, appreciate them. So Mr. Ramurthy, I think we are almost coming to a closure now. I think my question, I got distracted with the caller. I wanted to understand, like, you know, you have a full-time career and then you have a family, and then after looking at the magnitude of work Seva Bharati is doing, this itself looks like 48-hour, not just 24-hour thing. So how do you balance work life and Seva stuff?
Yeah, I think COVID is an exception. We had to really stretch ourselves to, you know, reach out to communities, people, funds and all this stuff. It really took a lot of time. And I had to really sacrifice office for service in this occasion, on this occasion. But in general, in the normal times, I think, you can stretch a bit and give time for both. And a lot of the meetings and all we schedule on the weekends. And so you're covered there. And then on the weekdays, you spend a couple of hours, 1 or 2 hours every day. So that's how it is. And I think a lot of it is because if you're interested in a particular area, I think the time will come by itself. So that's how it is.
Okay, good to know, Mr. Ramurthy. And then, I wanted to understand this Seva. Like, you know, when somebody, is motivated and then, like, you know, and then he wants to join or work with you. And if somebody brings in some new idea, would you entertain those things or you only stick to your area of work?
No. New ideas are welcome. There's nothing like, nothing is fixed in stone, right? I mean, any new idea that's going to impact, scale, that can bring in scale, that can really help people is welcome. Run for Girl Child is an example, right? We got a suggestion from one of the volunteers. This can be a game changer to bring the issue of girl child empowerment. And so 5 years, great success. You know, we get about 10,000 runners, and a lot of empowerment, a lot of publicity and stuff like that. So I think, yeah, welcome.
Okay. And then I think my final question, the people who actually benefited from your programs, like, you know, the kids who grew up, got married or like, you know, got a job, do they come back to you and then serve? What did you observe? Like, you know?
Yeah. So typically guys who have been with us, they come back to us. We've seen a lot of girls who get married and they're still working with us, or they give part-time. A lot of people who actually got employment after staying with us, they come back. They donate, actually. They come back and donate out of gratitude for the help they got in the orphanage, right? Mm-hmm. So I that's a very common thing in Seva Bharati. It's like a family, so people come back to us.
Okay, and then are there any other organizations collaborating with Seva Bharati?
We work with a lot of partner NGOs. So we work with many of them actually, based on context. We work with them. Yeah.
Okay. And then you're based on, like, you know, is the youth getting attracted? What is the main age group of your volunteers? Like, you know, is it,
yeah,
like,
it's,
you know,
mostly. It's mostly, you know, it's between 2018 to 35 types. Yeah, that's the range.
Okay, that is very good to know. I think It's been like, you know, wonderful talking to you, Mr. Ramamurthy. Do you have any, like, you know, final appeal to make to all the listeners of Telugu NRI Radio before we close this?
Thank you, Arvindji, for the opportunity. And my only request is, you know, tough times across the globe, not only in India, but we have our challenges in India. I think there's a certain sensitivity required from all of us towards the needy population of the country. So I request all of you to support Seva Bharati or any other organization you want, especially in the areas of healthcare, skill development, because it'll take a while for the economy to come back, and a lot of people will need support from you guys, rather from all of us, and you're part of that. So reach out to us if you want to support, and we'll definitely take all the help you can provide us. Thank you. Thank you very much, Arvind.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Ramamurthy Garu. And then, like, you know, indeed, it is an honor for me to talk to you, like, you know, through Telugu NRI Radio at a time when, like, you know, so many of us are even scared to venture out, even to buy our own groceries. You and your volunteers are actually leading and then doing service to the people who don't even, like, you know, who you don't even know. That indeed is, like, you know, a great thing. And then it's an honor that, like, you know, you gave us this opportunity to have a discussion on the Seva Bharati work. And thank you. Thank you for joining at this late time, a late hour in India. Appreciate it. And then I think maybe after all this is done, maybe we can come back later and then go over a few other things. So with this, listeners, that was Sri Ramamurthy Garu, Secretary of Telangana Seva Bharati, joining us, like, you know, discussing the COVID service. This is RJ Arvind from Charlotte signing off. Next time we'll meet with another personality discussing something that is current. Thank you. Thank you again for listening to us. Namaste.